forever etched in my mind, because from there you could see some small, small clouds below, and you could see the whole route through which we came. And I couldn't believe that I have come this far without any attack of asthma. That day I got to know that the asthma was this many years that I was struggling and trying to adapt. I think at least will not come between me and the mountains. So it was not only the joy of reaching to the top of any mountain, but it was also a sense of freedom, a liberation, sense of liberty. It's feeling, you know, that which I can only relate to. Imagine I have some birds caged for a long time and you give them freedom, you know, the kind of feeling they might have. I think I could relate to that. And then there was no looking back, and I started going and doing everything that I wanted to do, which the mental lock wouldn't allow me to do. Those were paragliding certification, horse riding certification, scuba diving, everything. Like, you know, I thought I went and I got associated with Bangalore Mountain Club, and I started going to each and every trek every weekend there, and slowly, slowly I became. They identified me, I was managing well, so they made my trek free as the happiest person in the world. Wow, I can go to trek without paying any money. And then, after 1 year or so, I started getting paid for taking trips. And I'm rich. And I think that's the perfect spot if you want to be, that where your passion is, you can make money out of it as well as you can enjoy. It was great. So, then in 2010, I got an advertisement, this Everest base camp trip. I thought, wow, not bad. And I was going through some turmoil and I wanted to pray for you. I just wanted to go somewhere. First question I think was, is there an installment? You know, this installment story is with me till now, but I'm like, I'm always in loan, because I always live my life, maybe how I should live my life 5 years later in financial capabilities I live now. I think king size will be another statement. But I, when they agreed for giving an installment payment, so I went for this Everest base camp. And the first day when I reached Nepal, Kathmandu, I was not sure why people were so much, like, you know, so much madness about this mountain and all. Everywhere you see, you look at their barber shop, it's like Everest barber shop. You look at a butcher shop, it's like Himalayan butcher shop. I mean, like, everywhere. And every nook and corner, there are discussions on mountains. Any coffee shop you go and you try to get some books, those are all mountains. Frank, till that time I never knew what was the exact height of Mount Everest. What should I know? Right? How many of you know? Oh. Good. No doubt you are a IIT. But I didn't have any question. I believe that those information which I can go and get in Google by the way, if you look at it. So only faint memory of Everest was in the children's book of knowledge. There was a picture, I still remember. Tenzin not be holding a something like a hammer kind of thing with 2-3 flags, with some mask and some white. It didn't make sense. Later on, I tried to think that why there was no picture of Edmund Hillary. Later, I got to know many things that when Tenzin and Hillary went to the top, so Hillary took the picture of Tenzin. And then he asked Tenzin to take a picture of him. And he realized that Tenzin doesn't know to click a picture. And he realized 8848 meter is not a place where he can teach Tenzin how to take a picture. And hence, there is no picture of Tenzin. But there are a lot of this kind of funny stories also. Like, this is an actual story though. But the funny story was, there is, nobody knows who climbed first, right? Two of them went, right? who stepped first. Because they all came back and they said that we are united, we went together. We don't want to go into that discussion at all, that who went first. We both went, that's it. So, Tenzin, Sultani was about to get those sir thing knighthood, and Hilary said, Tenzin, you need to come to Europe. Look, the press there will be very, inquisitive. We would want you to know who climbed first. Don't ever tell. But these are the stories of the Sherpas. They said that don't ever tell that you climbed first. Tenzin said, yeah, yeah, fine, I will not tell that I climbed first. So they went, and the media asked. So he was trying to avoid, but then at one point, he had to say. So they asked that, who climbed first? So Tenzin said, I don't know who climbed first, but I climbed second and Hilary climbed third. I don't know the truthfulness of this, but shepherds like to believe that. So disclaimer, don't quote me. But I personally believe, and I think you should do some research on George Mallory. He might have climbed first the top. He might have. There's some evidence, there are some documentaries in YouTube. You should have a look. His body was found after 70 years. So it's an interesting thing to know. I'm just giving you pointers. And so after all these stories, the first day when I went for the trek, you don't get to see Everest. So I could sense the excitement among my team members, and they are like all excited. I think I was the only one who was not excited about it. Like, yeah, it's Mount Everest, yeah. Okay. So, second day, when we started going, so I also felt some, what is it, like inquisitiveness. Okay. And then I realized, so after some hours, you see Mount Everest in front of you. Trust me, we stood there for 2-3 hours just watching Mount Everest. The plumes coming from the top of the hill, so there will be like snow kind of thing. Snow plumes, and it was so fascinating a beauty, like I can't explain. And we started discussing that, so my friends were there, they said, next year we're coming here, we're going to climb. And I told them, you know what, I heard that it's a little tough, so maybe next year I'll come. And there was literally a fight, like verbal fight, oh, you are teaching, be a sportman, like, come next year. No, next year. But I promised Mount Everest that I'm going to come back. And it was something like cast a spell. Mount Everest, I mean, it was so mystic. I can't explain. And then I went to the Everest base camp. Then from Kalakata, I took this picture of Mount Everest. And then while coming back, I brought two books. One was Into Thin Air, two days back there was a movie also based on the 96 disaster. A lot of people died. And then another book was this Paths of Glory by Jeffrey Archer. It's a story of George Mallory. So I happened to read Into Thin Air first, and then I was shocked. I was shocked, first of all, that I never knew what was mountaineering. I thought it was Mount Everest was yet another trekking peak. You can trek and go, just that you have to carry some oxygen, because maybe at that height you don't get oxygen and maybe it's a little tough. And when I read that book, it was written that that time in 96 it cost you 35 lakhs to climb Mount Everest. And then I was counting how many years I had to work without touching my salary to get that, and then add inflation to that. And the number was definitely not too exciting a number. And second, I saw all those equipments for the first time. I mean, like, crampon, ice legs, I was like, I have never seen those. And then I was depressed, like, you know, this was one of the dreams. I was so vividly visualizing the dream. And within a moment, the dream got crushed. And like, crushed is also, I mean, small adjective. Then suddenly after 3-4 days, as I said, that you can put logic to everything you do. I thought, what if I get a call from Kaun Banega Crorepati? The probability is very less, but it's not impossible. I might get. What if I win? Then can I still go to Mount Everest? The answer was no. You know why? No. Because number one, I don't have the skill to go and climb the mountain, and number two, I don't have the experience to go and climb. So I decided that I need to stay prepared to get lucky. Because people don't get lucky just like that. People get prepared for some opportunities, and when that opportunity comes, they can identify and they can take that opportunity, and then they become lucky. But the other people, they just see and they say, oh. Right. So I thought to get myself trained at Himalayan Mountain Institute actually. And that time, I decided that should I wait for to work for some more years, become rich, and then go, I mean, that much money, because it was hunting always, right? That much money, how do I go? So then I realized that time, health and money, all three together, is very difficult to have. It's not impossible, but most of us, I would say 95% of people, you might not have this time, health and money. Now what is time, health and money? Now, as students, you might have all the time and all the health, but you are not earning, right? Isn't it? Now when you will go slowly to corporates, you will do some job and you will become, because you are from IIT, you will be the cream, so you will have a lot of responsibilities. And you might earn a lot. You have health, you have money, you won't have time. Trust me. And then when you become a Ratan Tata, you have all the money in the world. You have all the time in the world, but maybe your health won't be that satisfactory or that encouraging that you can go and climb. Of course you can, but that's not so evident, right? So you have to make a choice that when you want to do that. So I thought maybe that was the right time. No matter what, let's give it a try. Let's see where I can reach. And then I decided to go to Mount Kilimanjaro. And when I was, because I was fascinated by Africa through some childhood novels I used to read, and of course, I don't know how many of this generation read those comics books, Phantom and all, like, you know, so those were in Africa and everything. I lived more in those unrealistic world with comics, mandrakes and phantoms and all. But then when I started studying about Kilimanjaro, so this was more of, so I went for HMI course, I got trained, and I knew that I got the skill, I need to get some experience. And the easiest one was Kilimanjaro, which was not technical mountain, yet you get a high altitude exposure. So I was studying about that, and I got to know that Kilimanjaro was a part of Seven Summits. And I was thinking, what is the Seven Summits? In the Wikipedia, you can see it's a part of Seven Summits. And then I opened the link and I saw, wow, seven highest mountain on each of these continents. Fascinating. And it's a great excuse to roam around the world, right? But then I laughed at my dreams, because I can't even think of Everest, which is like so costly, and now I'm thinking of not one but seven. So then, as intelligent people say, you add anything infinitely, you multiply anything infinitely, it still is infinity. So I considered, it's just like, what if I can go to Mars? If I can go to Mars, that's an infinite dream, right? So then I can say that when I'm going to Mars, let me go to Pluto also and come back. So it's like equally infinite. So if I have to dream that infinite dream, let me dream. Do it in style, right? Anyways, people will laugh at the dream, make it large. So it took some time to digest, and I mean, my heart was also not allowing me to feel that. And this happens with most of us, right? We don't dare to dream that big, thinking, If I ask the mother, you can go and climb Everest, she said, no. I said, let's go to a mountain, let's go to Kilimanjaro. She said, no, I think I cannot. As soon as you say that I think I cannot, you definitely cannot. Because you'll give up before even trying. And that happens to all of us in some aspects. Right? So I thought, it took me some time, and then I convinced my mind that, yeah, let me dream that. Let me write it down. And I started writing. And then I thought, what if I do Kilimanjaro? And I get some money, maybe I get some promotion. What would be the next mountain? I said, yeah. So I started off the mountains. I said, next tough one is Elbrus. Okay. Now imagine Elbrus is also done. I was like in the imagination, you know. So what if everything is possible, that kind of state. So after Elbrus, maybe Aconcagua, people have said like through blogs and all. And then Denali, and then Everest. So it was suddenly became, everything was possible, like, you know. Once you start dreaming big, you see that all the limitation just goes off, and you are into a different world altogether. And for the time, practically, it was highly impossible to do. Like, where will I get that much money? How can I do like on these mountains? I don't even know how my body will react. But then I chopped out the plan one by one, that after this, this, and then last week we might some massive mountain. But reality was different. Fine. But I finally went to Mount Kilimanjaro. Kilimanjaro, this is on the way. Oh, there was an interesting aspect. So I started arranging this climb, and I realized that it was a number game. That more the number of people, the cost gets reduced. So we found 3-4 people from Everest Base Camp, my friends. Those people came. Then we approached Bangalore Mountain Club, and I told that, you know what, why don't you pitch to the company and you might get a more discount. And then we pitched and we got some more people. And the condition was I had to leave the mountain. Okay. So one fine day I get a call. One guy, he told that I want to join your expedition. I said, good. So which all treks have you done before? I said, treks? No. This is my first trek. And I told, may I know your age? He said, I'm 55. And he said that I want a gift. This is a gift to my wife. My 25th anniversary. My wife is a better. And I want to go. And I said, and I thought, like, okay, might be a fit guy. I told him, so. How often you go to the gym? The gym? I have never visited a gym. And then he realized my concern and said, oh, for your information, I am a chain smoker also. For a moment, I saw myself behind the gym. This guy will die. I will go behind the gym. I immediately called up Bangalore Mountain Club and I said, I am not leading this trip in this life. No way. And then he finally told that, no, his wife is there and I will get an indemnity bond and this and that. I said, nowhere I should mention officially that I am leading this trek if something happens. But I thought still, let's make it possible. And suddenly, after day three, we came in front of this wall and you see people? These are people walking up. So when I saw this, see these are people walking up. I was like, oh my god, in HMI they never taught climb this bigger wall. And the first impact was the fear. Fear of unknown. What will happen here? And all of us were like, stand still, watching that and scared and like, you know, we were shrinking. But here, how many of you are from computer background? Anyone? But physics? Many? Okay. So, here also, as I said, intelligent people, they try to justify and find a good reason to do something which they always want. So, there was a time where the Siri writing was there. You know Siri? Siri? Now the DVD writing is there. That time Siri writing came out in the market, and the speed of the city rider was 4x, 1x and 4x. Now the researchers, they always tried to increase the speed, but every time they saw that due to the centrifugal force, the track was going out, it was not riding properly and the city was getting damaged, and nobody was able to manage a speed more than 4x. Then suddenly one of them, they came up with a theory that, which is a well-known mathematical theory, that if you take a circle and you break the circle into delta distance, each of these delta distance is a straight line, and they change the algorithm of writing from a circular algorithm to a linear algorithm, and guess what, from 4x it became 48x. So it's a huge paradigm shift and technology development happened because of that. And I liked that approach very much. I appreciated that when I read in the book. So suddenly I came and thought, like, let's break this into delta distance. Now delta distance might not be that microscopic distance, but one small delta would be maybe a step. Right? So one step, how difficult can a step be? If it's not an overhang, it's a straight also. How difficult can it get? Maybe I have to put my leg even higher. Nothing more than a step. So if I take one step, the next step, and the next step, I think it's possible. So I told my team that keep small targets, right? So go to 10 steps and then we'll celebrate. And that way, one believe when we actually went in, we found that it was even simpler. It was simpler than what we perceived it to be. So our life's problems are also like that. When you look from far, it's like it becomes a fear. The fear of unknown, it crumbles us and we start to put some masala in it and try to make it even difficult for us. But when you actually jump and tackle the problem, you see that it was not tough. And now when I look back, it was not even tough. So like that, we go and we climbed this, and let me show you one small video of Kilimanjaro. Why I'm showing this video is, I'm sure at least 10 of you will climb Kilimanjaro within 15 minutes.
Praise God, praise Thee, oh,
fact, this mountain, each and every one of you can climb. Only you need to have the strong motivation to go and do that. So only when you get a call from within, you will go and do that. It all depends on practice. So we have how many 10 minutes more? I'll just quickly finish up. Yeah. So nobody can go and do it solo. It all depends, like, you know, so you have to already have a teamwork. And imagine you have to miss that day, you have to go and get the water, you have to cook, you have to drink, you have to put everything, you have to pack. It becomes difficult. But when you have a group, you can always share that experience, share that responsibilities. And then sometimes you need to do a good planning. Here it is in Denali, we had to put some walls to protect our tent so that it doesn't blow up. And then some places it's about mutual trust. So to cross this kind of areas where there are fall of more than 1,000 meters on each side, and there is no fixed rope, and you have to walk on that, and you are tied to each other with the rope. And this kind of mountains, you cannot randomly go with anyone and everyone. So you have to have a good understanding. You should know not only the strength of each other, but the weakness of each other, so that you can go and complement each other. But then it's all about tackling your fear. It's all about looking at the fear eye to eye and then conquering it. So you don't conquer the mountains, you conquer the fear that you have, and then you move. And then not only that, you need to have the right gears, and then you need to pick the right fears. So whatever you are seeing me with this big belly, well, before many mountains, 2 months before, I had to evolve and transform into a totally different person. It's a curse that I was born in Bengali and I love Swiss. But but trust me, when we go to mountains, there are a lot of training that we need to go through. And I have a checklist of, say, swimming 2 kilometers, 45 kilometers cycling, then 15 kilometer run, 120 floats going up and coming down. I mean, like the list is endless. But what I'm telling that every mountain, if you have to enjoy those mountains, understand the mountain, what it means, prepare yourself and then go, then you can enjoy those mountains a lot. And after all these things, you should also be ready. If you want to pursue mountain training, be ready to face situations where your dreams will be like taken and crumbled and broken to pieces many times. So that Everest dream was there, and in 2015, when after a lot of hardship, we cut down the cost of Everest from what was 35 lakhs in 1996, we reduced to 14.5 lakh without the equipment though in 2015. And we cut down all unnecessary things, everything we said that we can do this by ourselves. And we did crowdfunding, and my college gave me 6 lakhs out of nowhere. And when I thought that I would eat out and suddenly get that money. But after all this, when finally we were approaching the base camp, suddenly there was this earthquake in Nepal. In 2015, that earthquake took almost 10,000 people in Nepal died. And just after the earthquake, there was a huge avalanche in Everest base camp. We were just 1.5 hours before the base camp. And 21 people died in base camp from Kumori, big thing came. So when we got to know that our expedition is cancelled, and all the money was lost, we didn't want to accept the fact. We were still in a denial mode. To that extent that we were so insensitive, we went to the base camp trying to figure out, can we still go? Can we take a helicopter to camp 2 and then start? And where 3-4 dead bodies were still lying there. And we became mad. Let go off was like the defeat. We were not able to accept, digest the fact. It's all over. But after we were then roaming around, and suddenly I got to see this book. This book was crumpled and kept, like, you know, because of those avalanche. The book name was Dead or Alive. And a shock came to my mind. And it was like, I don't even know the person who was reading whether he or she is dead or alive. Then I got the realization that it's not about just trying to do something. The greatest gift is that we are alive. We couldn't tell me. Mountains will be there, if not tomorrow, if not there next year. If I have that will, that want, I will come back. Maybe at my 65 age, I will still come, but I'll come. So I took back all those broken dreams, came back, started stitching those, and in the meantime, I went and climbed the highest peak of Australia. And then in 2016 again, we went, and then I do tell people about this. By the way, Paper Liver is one of my sponsors. Have you ever quantified? You guys are all scientific minds, right? So have you ever quantified how much time you have? Quantified in the sense that if I, at the age of now, almost 35, if I think that I will live up to 70, so I have another 35 years. If I quantify that, it's not a long time. 1 year, 53 weekends. So it's like 35 and 53, 1600, 1700 weekends. Maybe my bucket list is more than that. So if I do 1 month in each weekend, still I will not be able to finish in my lifetime. That's if I'm too optimistic that I'll be alive at 70. So living by the moment is very important. And when you realize that the time, what we typically think as infinite, you don't even think about death. You get scared about death, right? You don't want to think also. I think we'll appreciate your life more. And then you will see that all these small things, small like what politics and what these and that won't even matter. You are not here to earn money, you are not living to earn money, but you earn money to live, right? So it's living and live every moment, because with all the money in the world also you cannot buy one more hour in your life once it's gone, right? So anyways, that's a thing to ponder upon. And even after 2015 earthquake, even my next door neighbor had 1,000 reasons why not to go to the West, why I should not go. But then it's all about that one good reason that will keep you moving. And then in 2016 we went to Everest, and we went to this Kumbu icefall, we crossed this icefall, and those are the people. And here in these situations you can't even sneeze or you can't even cough, because these are big towers of ice. Unstable blocks of ice, it can fall off anytime, and you have to start in the early morning such that you don't, it doesn't melt and go. And then there are big crevasses, and let me show you another few videos. So when we were, we get into this camp, there should be oranges. In the night time, it used to happen. We should get scared. The first reaction was, let's run. The next reaction was, where will we run? If that big thing comes, anyways, better like, you know, die properly, still have a head so that you don't get hit by stones. But anyways, those kind of things did happen. Then, just like in your college teaches you to face your corporates. That your corporate is something like this. You are getting trained. So this is how you should go across the road, across the ladders, the corporate ladders. Have you seen the implication of physics here? There is no fixed railing or such. You pull the rope pulls you back the tension. That gives you the balance. And when the first time they shape of a bhaji, he did that, it was like, are you kidding? Nothing solid to hold. But then we realize once you know the science behind it, it becomes so easy. And just like when you will be out of your college and you will be going to corporates, and you will find, oh my god, it's in the night. The college taught me the day. But then there is always a choice that how you want to look at this, right? The choice is with us. It's a reality. reaction is with us. The response is within us. You can always find the good thing behind it, that you won't even know how deep it is. So you can just go and cross. You don't even want to see the face of the other climber who just went. So you will be like scared to the death. And so these are the positive sides. The choice is yours that which side you want to see. And then finally, at the top of Mount Everest, this is the video. The highest point on earth, beyond which no human being can keep their feet, because there are no more places to keep the feet. At this point, after a lot of struggle, we managed to take some pictures in this video. There are a lot of stories some other day I'm telling. But one of these pictures that I came to recall, that became maybe the most circulated picture of the summit of Everest after Tenzin and Hillary. Because that picture made its place into the biggest scandal on Mount Everest. The police who are supposed to be in the custody of law and order, the police couple from Pune, they took my picture, mocked my picture, my face, and my picture was something like this. They put a flag and they claimed this had climbed the mountain. They got a certificate, and then I had to bust that out because they put a copyright of my picture. And like, you know, it was a horrible time because I had to run the next almost 3-4 months. I had to run to prove that my picture is original and theirs was a fake one. And that appeared in all the newspapers in the world. I don't know whether you have gone through that or not, but yeah. So teamwork, and yeah, this picture was that picture, and maybe you can search in Google later on, 2016 Everest. But then again, not everything is very rosy in this mountains, I must admit. There are darker side also, but the inspiring thing is all these can be prevented also. These are the result of some mistakes that people go through. So, three of my friends died in that expedition. They are from Bengal, not on our expedition, so there were three teams. So, second team, which had four people, three out of four died. So, their body was brought back 1 year later. And the kind of struggle the family has to go through, the pain, the family has to go through to bring the dead body back, it was horrible because the body was brought back after 1 year. But yeah, you have to be very cautious and not just go by the flow, be prepared and tackle. And it's just like driving in the road and those accidents can happen if you make a mistake. So mountaineering is also something like that. Only thing is that the level of carefulness is has to be multiplied. So it all depends on when you try to achieve something, or you have put a goal in front of you. Depends on the want that you have, and how desperate you are to reach that goal. How much is that? Is that is allowing you to sleep? Is it? Fear will come. Fear will be there. I also get scared so many times, and that may be the reason that in a cold morning also I do wake up and go for that run. Who wants to get out of that cozy bed? That fear. If you channelize it in the proper way, it can be used as a tool, as a constructive mechanism for you. So, as I said that before, every mountain, 2 months before the mountain, you can, I have to go through those stress. It's because of the fear. I could channelize that fear. So, are you ready to give up, go beyond the limits? 2016, 2017, I wanted to go to Mount Wilson Massif, 2016. And I tried for bank loans. Oh, by the way, I had to leave my job before going to Everest. So the company told me that either you go to the Everest or you and leave the job, or you stay in the job, don't go to Everest. But then my want was more, I knew that if I am smart enough, I can come back and always find another job. job, right? But if that pulls me back, the fear of losing my job, I can never do anything in my life. So I chose the latter. I went and left my job. The very next day, I got my job back as a consultant with 30% hike on the same company. So did not to be that everything that you think is a negative thing, you can actually change it to a positive thing, right? And now I'm still a consultant with that company, and that helps me to take 3 months leave, 2 months leave without being in the policies of the company. And then 2016, when I almost planned and I was applying for loans, personal loans, there was this demonetization and the bank denied giving me loans. Somehow I managed to lend some money from some people, close friends. Just when I was about to give that money, I realized that the flights to Antarctica from Chile, the flight cost around $30,000, which is around 18 lakh rupees. The seats were all full. Not a single agency could give me one seat, even when I had arranged that money in spite of all these problems. So, big enough dejection. But that day I decided that I have to make this setback as the biggest inspiring thing for myself. And you know what? I decided that next year, if I have to look back at that incident and see that that event happened, and if I have to make it positive rather than a negative one, then I have to do something more than that, what I was supposed to do. Because if I go and climb next year also, the same mountain, I still lost 1 year. 1 year in mountaineering is a big loss. So I thought, why not go and do a skiing also together? And then good. Then I thought, you know, the wish list goes on and on. And then I thought, when I'm going to Chile, let me also climb the highest volcano in the world, active volcano. So then I add that also. And then I thought, for preparation, I should climb some more mountains. And I added that also. And then the cost of the expedition became 71 lakhs, and I didn't have money. That was good enough reason to give away the dreams and just get back to work. But then I went, I tried hard, I got some sponsorship, but it was not enough. And then I talked about, are you willing to give your all? I went, and whatever things I collected over these last few years, going to mountains, be it a stone from Everest, be it a stone from here, be it some handicrafts from there. I started putting them in an auction in Facebook. And because that was the only thing I could do, and I took loan also, but that loan was also not sufficient. I took around 31 lakh rupees loan, but still it was not sufficient. Then people came forward and they contributed to the crowdfunding, and the last moment, that expedition was possible. So it all depends on are you willing to give your all? Are you ready to take that kind of challenge? So I think it all depends on the priority, and it all depends on the want that you have. So you can always find your excuses to not go. You can find hundreds and hundreds and thousands of excuses. But remember, the only people who can stop us from achieving our dreams are we ourselves and our excuses. So if we can get away with that, so dream big, and just dreaming won't help. Chase your dreams to make it possible. Okay.
Thank you, Satyarup sir. From being an asthmatic kid to climbing the Mount Everest, from being an engineer to mountaineer, it was a highly motivational talk. So, if some of you have questions, you can take it.